cool. It sounds great. Yeah.
Yeah, you can definitely tell you're having fun with it, dude. Like, that's, I think that's what I like a lot about your stories and stuff like that. I just see how you invest yourself in there.
Thanks, man.
It just seems to be like a home run after home run, dude. So
Thanks. Sure. Well, I love the ways you guys, you guys seem to pick up a lot. I mean, we, all of us wanted to put a lot of little like Easter eggs and things into Warlords, and it was super fun hearing you guys pick up on all that stuff. You know, like you, yeah. like the Blue Boys figured out what the, you know, what that, what I was talking about when I, yeah. when I, you know, yeah. when I put the Blue Boys in there, and the inner cover stuff, with the little pieces of,
it was crazy. I was
the speeches that people had made and all that.
Yeah, because I was telling Dan today at work, I was just like, man, I had to reread it again, you know, to, you know, do my homework and get prepared again. And I was like, man, there are so many more Easter eggs that I just found again rereading it. I was like, man, I'm just finding all these little golden nuggets. This is pretty dope.
Oh, thanks, man. The all the little bits of scripture in there from the Book of Luther.
Mm-hmm.
The Book of Luther mm-hmm. is like. The Book of Luther exists. Like, I wrote that, like, the whole book of gospel that I just nice. Went through and pulled stuff out of because I wanted it to feel legit, you know?
Wow. Yeah.
So I love it when writers do that. I mean, you can tell from reading Tolkien how deep it goes, and or even like even J.K. Rowling, you know, there's all these students that all have these huge backstories that you never find out, but you right. can just sort of tell that they're there because it's just. This world building
you had me
is such
going back
a great.
Forth too, because I was like, I was asking Dan too. I was like, did he write his own stuff at the end too, like the songs and stuff? Because I was like, man, this is pretty good too. I was like, I was Googling. And I was like, no, it's not on there. I was like, oh yeah, he is writing his own shit. Okay.
Yeah,
we weren't sure how to play.
When I wrote and you know, like in the top, usually like songs always have the composer written at the top. And I wanted to put anonymous up there, or like made, you know, make up a soldier or whoever. Mm-hmm. And and then one of the editors called me out, and they're like, do we have permission to use this song? And I'm like, yeah, this guy doesn't exist. This is my tune. He's like, well, should we do that? Like, no, it's okay. Like, no one else is gonna come out and claim this thing. I promise, it's mine.
Nice. Yeah, good stuff. I really appreciate stuff like that, especially the reread and then like find new stuff again. I was like, all right,
definitely thanks, man.
Something. Yeah.
Well, I look forward to you kicking my ass in whatever video game. That'd be fun.
I'm telling you, man, I don't care about that KD. I just want to have a good time, chill with good people, man. So I'm straight.
Oh, dude. Well, keep making these podcasts, man. I've been a big fan for sure. So,
thank you, man.
I'll give you guys a plug whenever I see you. Anyone.
Oh, really appreciate it. Big fans of you too, obviously.
Yeah, no, it's thanks, just man. Crazy how it all like came about. I mean, it all stemmed from just like I really still don't remember, Dan. Like, did we just come up like, hey, let's just hit up the comic book store, or
you wanted to find a comic book store to get like a physical copy of Walking Dead because you'd been reading them on digital.
Oh,
I
there
think.
We go. Yeah, okay.
And that's
yeah.
how this whole crazy adventure started.
Nice.
Yeah, we
and
just
were like, hey, let's review them.
Yeah, because like the one we went to the comic shop and the one dude that was there was just so knowledgeable and was just like, you know,
yeah,
yo, you want to check this out, you want to do this, you want to do this. And like, I mean, we've been going back to that same shop. Like, has it been a year now or has it only been?
No, not even that. In like 6-7 months, maybe.
Nice. Yeah. See, yeah. There we go. And it's just been awesome to see like where comics where I used to read back in the day. And just see now, like, I can just appreciate it on a whole nother level. And now to the icing on the cake, to actually talk to the writers, that's just awesome for me.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks, man.
Me too.
Well,
yeah.
We can talk about this stuff anytime, man. This is super fun. Somebody told me, like, the best thing about comic people is that nobody gets into it to get rich. Like, it's all about love of the game for, like, everyone.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Everyone just gets into it because they love it, you know? And that's... I love that
passion.
And it's so true.
You can, yeah.
It's kind of funny.
Even that person in the story you're talking about, like you said, like they is just so knowledgeable. Like I know so many employees like that at these stores that like they could talk for hours about all these different things.
Oh yeah.
Even about books that they themselves don't read or like, they know all about it. And
yep,
it's awesome.
Oh, dude, we got to set a timer, like, because we're coming off a break from lunch. And, you know, you can't be there for, like, an hour and a half, 2 hours.
We're at the comic shop, yeah.
Like, oh, no, we need to go back to work, man.
Yeah. It's funny, though, you mentioned, like, the comic community, you know, the creators are so, like, no one's in it for the money, so they're all kind of, like, in it together almost. And, like, I've kind of found the same thing with, like, with indie board game makers. I mean, like, all the creators I follow, board game creators I follow on Twitter and read about, like, they're all, it almost seems like everyone just wants to help everyone else, you know, make the best product they can, you know?
Oh, yeah, I can totally see that. I mean, I'm still pretty ignorant of that scene, but I'm going to check it out now, having talked to you guys. But, yeah, that's how it is in comics, too, for sure.
Awesome.
Like, when, like, I talk to people, and, I mean, a lot of people I know from outside comics don't get the comic scene, and they're like, yeah, so you went to Comic-Con? Like, did you dress up?
Yeah.
Like, no, I didn't dress up. Like, they just don't get, like, oh, man, you must be hardcore. I'm like, no, man, you got no idea how not hardcore I am compared to some of these people who go and, like, and dress up. And it's so comic people are some of my favorite people, man, because they're just so completely genuine.
Yeah.
Like, there's so little ego involved. They're just, they know what they love. And they,
Yeah,
it is. It really is. I love those people so much.
Like, that's I don't do too well in, like, big crowds. So, like, when I went to AwesomeCon, you know, I was just like, I was getting it here and there. But then the more and more I was talking to people, the more I found out I was getting more sucked in and, like, just hearing what they had to say, hearing what they've already experienced. I mean, like, cats were saying, like, oh, yeah, I was just storyboarding for, like, WB and, you know, like, doing, like, you know, working on this Marvel comic or working on the Marvel, you know, next movie. And I'm like, gosh, dang, y'all are just chilling here like it's nothing. Like if I was doing that, my head would be so big.
Yeah, man. And I was just geeking out about James Heron earlier, that artist I like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was at, he goes to Heroes Con every year. And so well, as far as I know, every year, Heroes Con is like the best con maybe ever for artists, like just to go and see these amazing, or you can go and see like all your heroes, like they're all there. It's fucking unbelievable.
Yeah.
And Heron was there.
Cause it's in North Carolina, right? That's the one in Charlotte.
Yeah. It's in Charlotte.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's in Charlotte. And, yeah, he had a table there and I was like, and I've met, big people just like shaking. It's like, hey, Mr. So-and-so. Not like that not that I'm friends with them or whatever, but I've met or shook the hands of big people at other conventions. And it was always cool. Like I've never been like mistreated by a pro or anything. I was just nervous to meet James Heron, man. And I was like, man, I just, this guy's work so much. I'm going to actually go over there and he's going to be drawing and see him drawing something amazing, like right in front of me. And I just, for some reason, I was just like starstruck. Like I didn't feel this way when I met Neil Adams, you know, like these legendary guys. I'm like, and James Heron is like, I couldn't believe it. I don't know why I even told that story, but
the last one that I went to at the AwesomeCon, I mean, I didn't have my sketchbook. I forgot it, but I had my tablet, my Surface Pro, man. I had a silver Sharpie. I had them sign the back of it. And like people were just telling me, dude, they were just sketching on it and just drawing it. I was like, oh, this is so badass. Like, thank you. You know, just shooting awesome. Shit, and I'm like, here they are just sketching. They're just like, yeah, of course I'll draw on this. And I'm like, oh, thank you. Like, let me buy your comic then, sir.
I guess that was my point. Like, everyone's so unbelievably cool at these things.
Yeah.
I'm sure there are people that aren't, but like everyone that I've met has been just awesome.
Right. Right. For the most part. Yeah. It's just a really good, that's why I'm glad my oldest son digs it. Like I was saying, my wife, she tolerated it. And then my 2-year-old, he had a good time, and then once that hour was done, he was like, all right, Dad, I'm ready to go. I'm about to flip out. There's going to be flip-out mode. You're going to want to take me out.
Middle of the floor.
Yeah, just like, I've had enough.
Yeah, that's fun to see, too. Like, this last Baltimore Con, there was a dad dressed up like, you know, whatever, Thor or something. And he was dragging his like 7-year-old around, just hating the shit out of it. and he was looking at another booth, and the kid was finally like, he just stood, he's like stomped his feet in place and he wouldn't move another inch, and he was like, can we go? It stinks. Like my favorite part of the day by far.
A little kid picking up on the essence of a con.
Yeah, totally. Oh, that's great.
That was so great.
That's fantastic.
Oh. It was so
fun. Yeah, dude. Oh. Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome, man.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, man. Oh, we got a little bit away from comics, but that's cool. No.
Excuse me.
I got another question, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Kind of to circle back around to when you were talking about like the world building you like to do. This is Tyke's question. So, Tyke, let me know if I'm asking it wrong. When you're like coming up with a new project, what do you place priority on? Is it like world building? Is it characters? Is it like the beats of the plot?
It starts with an overall concept, like a what if scenario maybe. In the end, it has to be about character. I mean, it doesn't have to be. You can do whatever you want, but the strongest stories I find tend to be about character. And it's kind of a cliche that you hear sometimes. You hear other writers say it. Say don't write plot, write character.
Okay.
And just see what everyone does, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, the best stories have the best characters. But so in the end, it should be about character. But when it starts out, it'll be just a kind of a concept. Like, let me just throw one out here. Say a Native American skinwalker story set in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
So one like a werewolf story, but not the way it's traditionally done with any of the, you know, silver bullets or full moons or any of that crap. It's all make it a, like a skinwalker. I think someone who steals skins and can change their shape.
Mm-hmm.
And think of that in a place like Hollywood, where your skin defines you. You know, where your what you look like defines who you are. That's the concept, but then it has to, in the end, it has to be about the characters that you're telling the story, or no one's going to give a shit.
Right.
So I'll start with, this is a story that this is a very basic pitch that so far hasn't gone anywhere. Say it's like a Kim Kardashian style, somebody who's trying to be a legit actress. And far has failed, and in some kind of a plane crash or something, she ends up with finding this like in a life or death situation in the wilderness, ends up finding this ancient not a temple exactly, but like an underground, like a pre-civilization sort of temple, like place of worship, where she finds this monstrous animal skin and she hides under it. And it, you know, in the end, it ends up saving her life. And she's shell shocked. And she ends up going back home with it to Hollywood, and she keeps the thing. And it's slowly turning her into this monster, kind of.
Okay.
Like where it's now and then she'll transform into this other thing and go out and murder and steal skins. And you have to see her, her as a person that is changing, like what's she going through, how did she get to be this way,
right?
Does she depend on, who does she care about? And it needs to be about that character more. Like I'll start with that concept, but it becomes about the character, and then you surround her with other characters that are just as complete, and all of them think that they're the hero of their own story. Sense?
Okay.
Hello.
Hello. Oh, you still there?
Oh my goodness! What
was that?
My son, he's watching YouTube right now, but I can stop it from the watch. But he keeps pressing play.
That's awesome.
I love trolling that little boy.
Which one is it, Matisse or Marceau?
This is Marceau. No one's supposed to be asleep.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Can you hear us? Oh.
Hello?
Still muted?
Let's see.
Nope. I hear sound.
Oh, you're
okay. There we go.
That's good.
We're good.
Oh, I hear you.
Yay.
Cool. Man, sorry. Good. I got no idea what happened.
That's weird. I mean, it could be the Discord servers too. Who knows?
Yeah, let's blame it on that. Let's blame it on that.
Hacking again. God damn it. I'm going to type small. So that whole thing that I said about the character, did that make sense?
Yeah, it did.
Oh, totally. Yeah, definitely did.
Actually, it kind of made me think, though. Was that like a story you've been thinking, because I kind of missed the beginning of that. Was like a story you've been thinking of, or are you just kind of like pulling stuff out of your head?
It was a story. I haven't thought that story in a long time, but it was one of many pitches that I had.
Okay.
A long time ago. I think I might have thought that one up before I even thought of Last Sons. I was trying to find the perfect artist for it, and it was going to be tough, kind of, because you had to find someone who, like, I really had a very distinct idea of what I wanted the character to look like. She had to be like, there were going to be a lot of women in the care in the story.
Nice. Yeah.
And
yeah.
You have to find someone who can draw them, make them look
man-ish.
You know.
Yeah.
Yeah, they got to look sensual and beautiful, but not like crazy, like white out porn stars like they sometimes do in comics.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, so it was a very specific kind of artist, and I found some that were great, but it never quite worked out. And then by the time, you know, eventually Last Sons worked out, and Warlords and other things came along.
Well, I was kind of wondering, when you were talking about it, have you read Glitterbomb?
No, not yet.
It sounds very similar to what, to what you were describing. It's Jim Zub, and it's just kind of like...
Yeah, okay. I know
this is like failed actress who tries to kill herself in the ocean, and this creature like gives her this power to eat people. So it sounded similar to what you were talking about, so I was wondering if you were like drawing off of that, but if... I mean...
I would highly suggest...
Like a lawsuit.
If you get a chance to, if you check out, I think, wasn't it like the very first panel in the first page or something like that?
Page two was just like
right off the gate.
Yeah. It's one of those comics where like you turn the page and like it's a full page splash panel that like slaps you in the face and you're like, holy crap.
Oh shit. Okay, I'll keep reading now.
Yeah.
All right. I'm looking it up right now, but I'm curious.
Glitterbomb.
I've heard of it. Actually, I think I remember you guys. I vaguely remember you guys talking about it. Actually, the same podcast. You guys picked up the same day or something.
Oh, was that the same podcast that we reviewed yours?
I remember if you reviewed it or not, but I remember I remember Tyke mentioning that you had picked up Warlords on a whim because you liked the cover, and I think he said that you picked up Glitterbomb the same day.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh shit! I think I see the panel you're talking about.
Yep.
Nice.
Yep, this looks sort of like mine. Cool. Well, I'm glad somebody made it work.
Yeah.
Nice.
I start with a broader idea, like in Last Sons. Last Sons started with the idea too of what if kids became like money,
right?
Kind of like the, what's it called? And Children of Men, that movie where like suddenly the whole world goes infertile, except it's only America. Like the richest country in the world can't have kids, but everyone else can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, I thought that was an awesome concept, man. Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. I mean, I've done some anti-human trafficking stuff, and it's a big deal to me. So it's something I knew something about. And back in 2010, when the earthquakes in Haiti were happening, about a group of Christian missionaries that went down to Haiti to they grabbed a bunch of kids and took them back. They were going to try to take them back to the States to get them adopted, but these kids still had families looking for them.
Oh wow!
And they just didn't have there just wasn't the infrastructure down there to help everyone find each other like there would be here.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of these kids didn't know how to find their families or vice versa. So everyone, they were just getting grabbed.
Wow. Never heard about that.
That's crazy. I can't believe it.
Yeah. Yeah. And so I found out a little more about the for-profit adoption industry and how that works and the, some of the problems that come with it, and it sort of blew me away, and it sort of happened. So they can't start with an idea, like a what if scenario. And then it ended up being more about this guy and his brother.
Okay.
And this little girl. And so focused on the characters and,
right,
you know, make, tell a story people care about at that point, you know?
Can you talk about, like you said, you did some anti-human trafficking work. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, sure. It's there was a group called Samaritan Women that work out of Baltimore. And yeah, I mean, it's Baltimore is, it's like Gotham City kind of.
Right.
And there's a lot of affluence, but there's also a lot of poverty and you know, some crime, and it's ideally located on the I-95 corridor to be kind of a hotbed for human trafficking. And there's I've done some outreach with that group, like just walking the streets and talking to people, trying to get them, get girls to know about the organization and give them a safe place to go to. And now there's this residence there that they house a lot of women who are, you know, rescued from abusive situations, primarily human trafficking. Done a little security at the building there, and you know, some education. I've taught some seminars to groups around here about human trafficking, about the risks, and you know, what you can do to stop it, and or, you know, fight it at least.
Yeah,
it's primarily awareness. Like, there's really not a whole lot of kicking down doors and, you know, saving lives that way. It's mostly just awareness, you know, like just making everyone aware of it and how, what it looks like and what they can do when they see it, not just turn a blind eye, because it's all around us, but it's really hard to see if you don't know what you're looking for. Yeah, mostly just awareness stuff.
Oh, well, that's great, man. I had no idea about that you were involved in any of that kind of stuff. That's great. It's good to hear.
Oh, thanks. Well, it's a big deal. And awareness is, luckily, awareness is definitely getting better.
Oh, good. Good. That's good. Well, I think we've exhausted our talking points. I mean, did you guys have anything else you wanted to bring up?
Hold on, let me check. Gary, you got anything you want to ask, Pimpin?
No, I'm good. You guys have pretty much covered anything that I had questions about.
Suspiciously quiet, Gary.
No, I'm listening because it's. I don't want to. You know how it is when you got like a group full of people or whatever. I just didn't want to be interrupting, and I know, like, say there was like a couple second delay or whatever. I just didn't want to be cutting anyone off. I was just paying attention to what he was saying and everything.
Yeah, I got to remember that. I have a bad habit because I'm just, I don't know. I'm just like, yeah, I'm excited, but I want to ask this. Like, oh no, he's still talking. Okay, hold on. I know, man.
I run into that all the time because when I'm talking with customers and all that, it's just if say they choose to use their car speakerphone or something, so there's automatically a delay, and so I'll start speaking when they're quiet, and they'll continue on, and that sounds like I was interrupting them. So I kind of learned to balance that, whether it's talking online or if it's talking on phone or what.
Nice, yeah. See, I need to learn that.
Okay, actually, I know a couple. If you still got time, Philip.
Yeah, whatever.
Oh, nice.
A couple questions actually typed out and didn't get to. What kind of advice would you give to an aspiring either writer or comic book artist trying to, you know, trying to break in and get their first book published?
Let's see. There was actually, you guys know the writer Charles Soule?
No.
I don't think so.
Charles Soule, it's Soule with E on the end. He wrote he's written a lot of stuff for the Big Two recently. Let's see, he did a run on Swamp Thing that was good. He did, he did The Death of Wolverine, actually, was him.
Okay.
Recently. I think he's been signed on as a full-time Marvel guy now. But anyway.
He wrote Letter 44. Okay.
Cool.
Yeah, right. He created his own thing. Was Letter 44. He did a.
Gotcha.
Oh shoot, the Lando, guitar 27.
Yeah,
he's done a lot of cool stuff. But anyway, he I think I first saw him on a show, like an online show with, God, I'm blanking on names, like crazy tonight. Blair Butler. She had this thing about comics that she did online on G4, back before G4 went away.
Right.
And see, Charles Soule was on there, and he said he had three rules that he laid out, and it's be good, be cool, and be around. And to expound on that a little bit, like,
okay,
yeah, like do good work, like make sure your work is good enough to be seen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, do good work first and foremost. Do good work, but then also, be sociable, be cool to talk to. Don't be a dick.
Right. Yeah.
And then be around. Be at conventions. Be a part of the community. Yeah. So first, have some good work to show, and then go out there and put yourself out there, and like physically and also online. Just be a part of the community, and go to these conventions and just meet people, meet other fans, but also meet other creators and just sort of be around,
Right.
Cool.
That's as concise an answer as I can give. It's actually a really good way to do it.
Good advice.
When he was saying be cool and be around, I took that to mean like conventions.
Mm-hmm.
But there is definitely an aspect of being cool online that you don't have to do, but it definitely helps to build a following. And that's a part of it that I admittedly am not good at and doesn't come naturally to me. Before I got into comics, I had no interest in social media at all.
I
had no desire to ever. I didn't have Facebook at all for years. Had no intention of ever getting one, and then started doing comics. And I went to a convention where Jimmy Palmiotti was there, and I think there was a panel on how to fund a comic with Kickstarter, I think.
Okay.
And Jimmy Palmiotti was on that panel, and he said he was talking about promoting the Kickstarter with social media, and he was like, "Yeah, so you get on there and." You put updates all the time. You put updates on your social media page, your Facebook, your Twitter, whatever. Everyone here's got Facebook, right?
Yeah.
And
nope.
You know, I didn't.
I do not.
Yeah. So I didn't. And I didn't say anything. But he was like, "Well, I hope everyone here has a Facebook, because if you don't, you're a fucking idiot."
Nice and blunt. Yes. Nice.
Yeah, that's literally what he said, word for word. I was like, "Right on. I guess I'm doing this." So I. Yeah, so, and you know he's right. It's free publicity. There wasn't any reason not to. Like, screw it, let's do this. And Twitter, almost more so. Twitter, like, I mean, the musicians that I know mostly are on Facebook, and some of them are on Twitter too, but Facebook is kind of their place.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas for comics, it's Twitter. Like, guys will just go on there and just... It's basically like a giant group text to everyone they know. It's a pretty solitary way to work. I mean, writers or artists, everyone's pretty much working by themselves, and they just talk through email or sometimes phone.
Yeah.
And they'll also just babble on Twitter too. Like they'll talk. There's a lot of interaction all day long on Twitter in the comic industry. So to be in the comic industry but not Twitter is a big disadvantage in my opinion. And I'm not as active as I should be. I mean, I'm on there every day looking around. I don't post enough or tweet enough, excuse me. I still I managed to scramble, scrounge up a few followers here and there, and I'm doing okay, but it's not like a point of pride for me or anything. I am definitely not as active as I ought to be. Certainly not as active as a lot of other people that do. Like Jason Latour is on there all the time, and he's super fun to watch. He's the artist for Southern Bastards, and he's one of the he's a co-creator of Spider Gwen.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Done a lot of cool. Yeah, he's done a lot of cool stuff. But he's also very very fun to watch on Twitter, and he's a template in how to be cool on Twitter. Follow that dude.
Cool, dude. All right.
Guys, sense a trend? Like, you seem to be asking a lot of questions on how to get started. Do you have some comic aspirations or just other creative aspirations?
No, just, excuse me, the whole, I'm very into the whole indie scene, you know, of indie board games, indie video games, indie books and comics and stuff. So the idea of like how to take something from a hobby to a paying job is always, for me at least, it's always right. interesting to see how people do that.
Yeah. What about you, Ty? Is that something you'd want to be doing?
For me right now, like, I mean, I did some pages and inking and stuff like that for this indie company, they're starting up. It's called 15 Year Comic. I'm just having a blast just working with those cats. You know, it's seriously just a hobby. I don't see how I can make a living from it just yet, but like something, what we're doing right now with this podcast stuff, like this is starting to be like a pretty good, like a good time. Like, it's like I'm learning stuff.
Yeah.
I'm having a good time talking. And at the same, it's just an overall good experience. So like, I appreciate it for sure. Dude.
Gotcha. Yeah. Well, you guys are doing a good podcast for sure. And I'm, you know, as far as making a living at it, like I know a lot of really great creators who don't. I mean, people whose work I love, who do other stuff. And I think I think there's something to be said for just doing it that way. my day job is not comics, you know, it's, I have no intention of stopping, you know, regardless of how much money I make in any given year, I'm not going anywhere, hopefully.
That's what I like and appreciate, dude, for sure. Yeah.
So you can just tell, like, you
bleed the passion about it, which is nice. And I'm hoping too, with this podcast, that we just keep having these overall positive experiences, you know? I think Dan is really on, to be honest, this is Dan's baby. And I'm really just like happy to be a part of it. Yeah. And Gary, I'm sorry too. And Gary's baby. It popped up out of nowhere. It was just like, Dan was just like, hey, Ty, you want to talk about this shit? And I was like, hell yeah, I'll talk, whatever. We'll talk about whatever you want to talk about, pal. And I don't know. Now it's starting to be like, hey, like, you know, well, it's Thursday. You know, do we go to the comic shop yet? We're going to, you know, what are we reading up next? Like, what are we going to talk about next? So it's pretty fun, dude. And
yeah,
I don't know, somewhere like therapeutic a little bit too, which is nice.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, for me too.
Cool. So just a couple more questions. Tyke, did you want to ask your big idea question?
Did I have one?
Okay, I'll ask it.
Yeah, your question anymore. It's been removed.
Well, see, here's the problem, real quick. I have this Woodford Reserve Burgundy. Burgundy. See, I'm telling you. I'm doing good so far.
It's a sponsor of Metal Dice.
I have my notes. I have my tablet. I was all prepared. And then once the shit happened where I just got disconnected, I'm like, well, fuck it. I'm just going to keep drinking.
It's all up to you. I this evening can still be saved.
All
right, I'll go ahead. So, if you can, try to correct me. So this question was kind of like, what is in your life, whether it's in comics or outside of comics, what is like kind of the big idea that guides what you do? Is that what you meant to ask, Tyke?
Yeah, it was sort of like, I think it was, again, like pulling inspiration, like what other, I guess what I'm trying to say is just like what other things inspired you? Like you've already tackled that question through this whole conversation, like, you know, like with the human trafficking, again, family, like family always seems to be like a big thing, which is nice. Just what are your tactics or your tricks to, like, you know, get that big idea across to, you know, to catch the viewer to, like, oh yeah, I want to get more. You know, like, you feed them just enough to, like, just keep them wanting, for me at least, to just want to keep learning more and more. And then, like, when it comes to the end, then it's like, well, shit, now what? Like, I guess I'm gonna have to find out what else to read now. So
I hate that. Like, when it comes either to comic books or just like regular books, say I'm digging, like I'm trying to learn something new and I get caught up in a book and run into the end, I'm like, well, now what?
Yeah. Just with Cade Murth, I'm like, oh yeah, especially the way it ended. Yeah. You know, when he gave a little message to the to President Roth or whatever, I was like, ho ho ho.
Shit about to go down.
Yeah, that's I'm not done. I'm not done with that story.
There's so much. Nice. I mean, you still got the blue boy. I mean, you could. There's tons of stuff that you can do with that, man.
Yeah, I intend to cover a lot of that too. Like yeah. I am. Yeah, shoot. I can't talk well, I don't too want you... much about.
Yeah, no, no.
Yeah.
I'll say as far as doing more of the comics from Boom, it's all reliant on sales. So if the trade comes out in July,
awesome,
like right in time for San Diego Comic Con. So if nice. That does like gangbusters, then who knows? Like
yeah,
if,
yeah.
like money talks, and if enough people tell Boom, we want more of this, and they tell them by buying the book. Then I would imagine they'll do more. But if that does not happen, there are other avenues. Whether in this form or another, I definitely have more I want to say with it, because it's just too personal of a story for me not to do more.
Yeah, I can,
you know?
Definitely. Yeah, yeah. And Chess, man, I want to say, yeah, Kate Mercer is one of my favorite, but Chess, that I want to say he might be my favorite character. Out of that out of that universe,
oh,
just because like
there's so much stuff. Oh God, I wish there was more already. Like I wish you could see, like there's so much cool stuff I want to do with him, and he's so much depth to him, and there's so much stuff I want to do with him. I will say initially, he was not supposed to be like at the end of. So you guys have read all four issues.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir. I did. I'm sorry.
Because I still want to spoil it for anybody here. I'm not. I guess there might be listeners who haven't, so I won't say anything crazy, but the way it resolved with Cade and his son, that with Chess, that was not going to happen initially. Like, it was going to be stretched out much longer. There wasn't going to be that bow tied on top.
Nice.
I still want to get back
at Augie, though, with that black dude when he was like, yeah, because I killed him. I was like, whoa, why did you say that, sir?
Yeah, he done goofed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, oh, no, your arm is gone now.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, there's so much more. But yeah, I without spoiling any of that, there's definitely going to be more coming. I don't know when.
Yeah.
But,
I
know, whether it's... Whether it's a Boom or down the road, but we'll see. As far as what you're asking about big ideas,
quick question. You say you go because I've only been to the Third Eye one in Annapolis. My friend that does the cosplay, he goes there often. Like he's close to Annapolis, he goes there all the time. Do you often go to that one when you're in when you're in Maryland and stuff? Or
yeah, that's the one I always go to. I've never been. There's only two Third Eyes. The other one is further
like
south.
Those, like,
I've never actually.
Like in Leonardtown. Is this Leonardtown or St. Mary's?
I can't remember the name of the town, and it's way south. It's I've never been there. I'm not sure which one would be closer to you, but it's I've never been to that one. But the one in Annapolis is awesome.
It was
enough good stuff about it.
The next time, if I don't know, after your tour or something like that, next time you hit over there, definitely hit me up. I'll make my way down there because I'm just coming from Alexandria, so I'll definitely.
Dude, that's awesome. Yeah, man, let's get a drink. That sounds good.
Oh, okay. You ain't got to tell me twice.
I'm in a good place.
Nice.
Cool, man. Yeah, that'd be fun.
Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah, big idea thing though. That's a heavy question. I don't want to get it wrong. Let's see. I mean, like if you're talking about like a theme, like an underlying theme that ties all my work together, I guess I would have to say it is that thing that I said already about it. Like everyone is the hero of their own story, and no one thinks they're evil. You know.
Yeah.
And I definitely have some like a couple of my stories have like bad guys, but I never try to. You know, I really try not to make them, mustache twirlers. Like even,
yeah,
know, even a rapist has a mom. You know, like everyone thinks
yeah,
they're
right. Yeah.
Everyone thinks they're justified, or everyone has their own sob story, and everyone has their own dreams and motivations. And, you know, it's just I want everyone to understand everyone else.
Right.
You know, like just understand where everyone else is coming from. And, see, now I'm going to quote someone. I'm going to quote John Stewart. Ignorance is common, but real evil is rare.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
You know, like it's, yeah. And it's, I try to promote that in my work, where like just the best villain, like, you know, Magneto, say, is Magneto is this great villain because he doesn't think he is the villain. He's a comic right. book guy.
He's one.
And he's got the muscles right. and the helmet and all that, and he looks the part, but he thinks he's saving his race, you know.
Right. Exactly.
Protecting the people he cares about, protecting his own family, you know, like Hayden is, you know, that's what he right. that's what he thinks he's doing. So that's good. Those good are the best villains.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A lot of depth to it too.
I would say you did not get that answer wrong.
Oh, good. Yeah, go ahead. Oh, I don't even remember.
Okay. All right, cool. I don't have anything else unless you guys, and it was the second time I've asked that, but.
I could shoot the shit all day, but yeah. I mean, it is almost 11:30.
Okay, cool. But,
I've asked all my stuff. I was just saying, I've asked all my stuff. It was just as a treat as I was hoping it would be. I hope we can do this again for sure, dude.
I know people talk this way, but like, hey, yeah, anytime. But seriously, like anytime, I'd love to do this again.
You too, man. Yeah. Cool. So, well, before we wrap up, I mean, is there anything you'd like to promote? I mean, you mentioned the trade for Warlords comes out in July.
Trade for Last Sons of America is out now. Cool. Trade for Warlords comes out in July. The first issue of Smoketown first issue of Smoketown just came out, and number two comes out in April sometime.
Okay.
And it'll be bi-monthly.
Cool.
Let's see. Yeah, some really cool license stuff that I cannot wait to talk about, but I can't yet.
And how can people follow you? What's your Twitter account?
Yeah, so on Twitter it's Philip K. Johnson.
And that's two L's, right?
Two L's and Philip. Cool. At Philip K. Johnson. And I've got a website, philipkennedyjohnson.com. That's Philip two L's, Kennedy like the president, Johnson like the lesser president.com.
Nice, man.
I'll throw all that in the description.
The Lost Boys of the U-Boat Bremen is on that site, and the art is killer. I'm really excited about that story too. It's all does 110 pages, all free, so please check that out. You can find me on Facebook. It's my full name, Philip Kennedy Johnson, and I'll hopefully be making more music and making more comics for a long time.
Cool. All right, well,
your tour too, man. Good luck with the tour and all that jazz, man.
Thanks
really
very much. Yeah, we leave for that in 2 weeks.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome. Actually, we got a gig in Virginia. Actually, let me see where that is.
Oh, please,
yeah.
I mean, Virginia is a big state and all, but let me just check
a little bit.
Internet.
So here's kind of a random question. So I don't know if you noticed, we call this podcast a muddled dice, but there's not actually a lot to do with alcohol. So, since Tyke's drinking, what do you drink, Tyke? Woodford Reserve Bourbon? I don't know if you're much of a whiskey or liquor guy, but what is your poison of choice?
I'm actually not a big drinker, but when I do, it tends to be beer.
Okay, good answer.
I drink a lot of ambers and reds. I don't really drink unless I'm on tour.
Okay.
And then I'll drink what's not. I'll drink with colleagues after the gig sometimes.
I got you.
I haven't had more than two beers at a time in forever. But I think looking I suspect Tyke's going to do his best to end that run. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't have a problem.
Woodford. Stop him anytime. Yeah. My Woodford Reserve is what I bought my artist for the first. There was no money in this book when we first started doing it. It was just some friends doing it because we wanted to, you know.
You're talking and, Sons?
Smoketown. Sorry.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Smoketown is the one I did with my musician friends, just for grins. And I got Scott a couple of payments of Woodford Reserve as he was doing the pages.
Nice.
He's a
that's how we
do it, guy, for sure.
Yep.
He's got a nice.
Gary, that's how I'm going to pay you for the board game art now.
Nice. I was just going to be expecting a crate to show up.
So that gig is on. It's on March 15th at 7:30 in Charlottesville, Virginia.
Charlottesville.
March is that close 15th. To any of you guys?
Charlottesville is in the middle of the state, right?
I do not know offhand. I'm Googling it.
Oh, these guys have lived in the state a lot longer than I have, so I thought they might know.
Where are you from, Dan?
Originally, I'm from California. Grew up in Santa Barbara.
Oh, that's cool. Right on.
Yeah.
Oh, let's see here. From Alexandria. Oh, shit.
That sounds like a no.
2.5 hours for me, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
probably closer for you to come to one of our local gigs.
Yeah, I'll definitely do that, though.
Yeah, we'll get you a local show.
Yeah, for sure, Pilgrim. Yeah, I thought it was like around Richmond. It is not. It is like, I got you.
Was it off to the left or something like that?
Yes, sir.
Is it down 81?
IMC, was it 1529? Looks like it's off of 64?
That's... What? Let's break off to the weather.
Yeah.
We're going to bring traffic.
Well, no, you go down,
hey, how's the traffic down there?
Hey. I have an excuse.
Okay. Boy, Ted.
I love you too, Gary.
Never mind the fact that it's 11:30. It'll be worse.
Has anyone seen
Logan?
No, I've heard it's great, though.
Yeah, God, I can't wait to see that movie.
Yeah, well, I was pretty stoked about the trailer.
Yeah, dude. Yeah, Logan, Kong comes out next week, and there's some fun stuff coming out.
No, man, this
Kong looks great.
Yeah,
I hope it's good. I can't tell what the tone is going to be, though.
Got to be good.
Yeah. I can't tell what the tone is going to be like. At first, it looked like it was going to be like super serious and hardcore, which is kind of what I want. But then I see, oh shit, John C. Reilly's in this. And he's, like, I saw another trailer the other day that was all jokey. And you know, it might still be great. I don't know. I just don't know what to expect, you know?
Yeah.
But it looks really cool, though.
Did you already say you saw the trailer? What was it the thriller joint, The Get Out? The one by Jordan?
Oh my God. That's supposed to be, like, amazing.
Yeah, that's I've been hearing like really good stuff on that, man.
It's like 100% had Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah.
And it had 100% for like, yeah. I can't wait to see that.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. A lot of great stuff out. Anyway,
all right.
I should probably call it. But Tyke, I look forward to getting drunk with you very soon. So, what kind of footage is going to be playing while we listen to this?
I don't know. I was actually going to ask you if you had any anything you wanted to see or
Arkham
see
Knight.
Behind Arkham. I'll report some Arkham Knight.
Let's talk shit about Arkham City and it's like the stupid like, you know, cat innuendos like when he's talking to Catwoman like.
Yeah.
Like, and I love that game. You know, it's like Last of Us is just such a great experience. Dude. And after that, like listening to Catwoman like purr, make some dumb cat pun. I'm like, God, is this really the best we can do, people?
Right. Yeah. Well, now you got me talking on tangent. If you dig the Last of Us, you got to play that Uncharted series as well. Another one developed by Naughty Dog. That's a pretty.
I know. Cool. I played about half of the first one, and I got pulled away by work, and I had not played any of the rest of them. So but I have like I think I have them all. I got the PS4 pack that came with the 1, 2, and 3 collection.
Yeah,
and I haven't played through it yet.
If you ever get the chance, definitely, especially for story, hell yeah, it's really
good. I know, man. Yeah, Neil Druckmann is like my guy. After Last of Us, I'll buy anything those guys do.
Yeah, agreed, dude.
I met Ashley Johnson at Comic-Con this past year, the woman who did the voice for Ellie. Yeah, she came in with Joss Whedon into the bar. Mm. Like the have you guys ever been to San Diego Comic-Con?
No,
I haven't.
Unfortunately, no.
At the Hilton Bayfront, there's a bar there. Odyssey is spelled all weird, like the C, like SEA. And that's where most of the comic hangs tend to happen. Not all, but like a lot of the big ones. And at some point, Joss Whedon came over, red faced. Like, just, I mean, I can be misjudging him. He seemed drunk to me. But with Ashley Johnson, I was like, "Oh shit, that's Joss Whedon." I was like, "Oh shit, it's Ashley Johnson, the girl from Last of Us." And I was like, so I practically ran over there, and Joss Whedon,
I
would have
done the same.
I was like gonna mob him, and I was like, "Excuse me," like to talk to. I was like, "Hey, love your movies," and like literally went straight to Ashley Johnson. I was like, "You are Ellie. Can I take a photo with you?" And she laughed right in my face, like because I just like sidestepped Joss Whedon to talk to her. And I was like, "That's the best game I've ever played by far." And then I asked her if she was gonna do another one. She straight up lied to my face and was like, "Nope, I don't know anything about it."
You do the same thing if we detected some of the licensed stuff that you were working on.
Yeah.
I'm trying to play it cool, like, here.
No, I'm definitely not working on that.
Nope.
Right. I can neither confirm nor deny said. I'm not even going to say it out loud.
Yeah.
But very soon, you guys will be the first to know.
Awesome. That would be a big boon to the podcast.
Yeah, seriously, I'll let you know. And as soon as it's out there, I'll link you guys on a thing.
Awesome.
Nice, brother.
Very cool.
All right. Well, before we go off on another tangent and keep you too long, I think maybe we should wrap it up. Really appreciate you being on the show. I mean, that's really awesome. This has been a great podcast and great fun talking to you.
Man, thanks. Good though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone listening, if you liked it, time. Was that?
I'll drink more next time. I'll be ready.
Yeah.
Okay. if we do a drunk cast, we'll invite you back.
I want to make sure I spelled it correctly. It's MINGUSH. No, GC. Hold on. MIN.
You want to do this after I stop recording so like your game tag isn't out there?
It's whatever. I'm not on that much. I just typed it in. Can you see the chat in there, Tyke?
Yeah. There we go. I got you. Yeah, that makes it easier.
Yeah, it's to if you forget it.
See,
you can look up Charles Mingus albums, and it's one of those.
Got you. That's the problem. See, with the podcast, I start drinking, and then I get comfortable, and I'm like, oh yeah, Dan's recording. Just don't mind me, man.
Right. All right. Everybody listening, if you liked the show, enjoyed it, please subscribe, comment. You'll be notified when we do more stuff. Hopefully we'll have Phil back on the show. This is a lot of fun. Thanks again for coming.
Yeah, man. My pleasure. Anytime.